Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome our virtual audience to the MSK review course for the 2021 Roentgen-Ray National Meeting. My name is John Baker. I'm an MSK radiologist at Mallinckrodt in St. Louis, and I'll be moderating the session today. A quick thank you to the Roentgen-Ray staff for organizing this session and for the chance for us to participate. As a reminder, we'll take some questions submitted by the audience at the end of our session today. Let's begin now with our first speaker, Dr. Hillary Garner from the Mayo Clinic Jacksonville, who will be presenting rapid fire MSK cases focused on variants and congenital lesions. Thank you.
Good afternoon. All the cases I'll be showing will be cases related to inherited disorders and or congenital anomalies and normal variants. I have no disclosures. So my first case is a 52-year-old man with chronic bilateral knee pain, increasing in severity on the left. On this AP standing flexion radiograph, we see separation of the supralateral corners of the patellae from the remainder of the patellae in a bilaterally symmetric fashion. The cortical margins along these lines of separation are well corticated. And on a corresponding axial proton density fat-saturated MR image, we see a thin plane of separation that is well corticated, as we saw in the radiographs, and the articular cartilage along this plane of separation is completely normal. There's also only minimal edema within that lateral bone segment. So the question in this case is, where is the most common location of the patellar secondary ossification center? Inferior, lateral, medial, or supralateral? And the answer in this case is supralateral, which is the location seen in this case. So this is a case of bipartite patella, which is a normal variant characterized by failed fusion of accessory ossification center, most often at the supralateral pole, as in our case, 75% in that area. Although this also can occur along the lateral margin in 20% and more rarely along the inferior pole in 5%. And the corticated margins of the accessory fragment and the main patella help differentiate this entity from fracture. This is most often asymptomatic, reportedly only 2% become symptomatic, usually related to abnormal stress along the synchondrosis, either due to direct trauma or overuse. And in cases of symptomatology associated with bipartite patella, you'll usually see marrow edema along that bipartite plane on MRI. Our next case is a 25-year-old woman with history of aortic replacement and pectus excavatum repair who has worsening postural headaches. We see on the sagittal CT image the concave or scalloped margins of the posterior aspects of the L1 as well as the L3 through S1 vertebral bodies as indicated by the black arrows. On the sagittal MR stir image, we see there is widening of the dural sac, particularly at the level of the sacrum where the sac is wider than the width of the S1 vertebral body. So the question in this case is, which of the following conditions can be associated with the spinal canal abnormality? Marfan syndrome, neurofibromatosis type 2, Proteus syndrome, or psoriatic spondyloarthropathy? Of these choices, Marfan syndrome is the correct answer. And you may have deduced that our young patient with history of aortic replacement and pectus repair has Marfan syndrome. So this is a dural ectasia in Marfan's. It's related to increased hydrostatic pressure of the cerebral spinal fluid pulsation with associated progressive dural sac dilatation. Usually occurs in the lumbosacral region because that's where the CSF pressure is at its highest. So in addition to Marfan syndrome, as in our case, other considerations are Ehlers-Danlos, neurofibromatosis type 1, not type 2, ankylosing spondylitis, as well as some other more rare entities. On CT or MRI, you can see that increased AP diameter of this dural sac in the lumbar region. Our next case is a 16-year-old boy who twisted his ankle after falling off a ladder. We see on this cone down oblique view of the midfoot, a small bony density projecting over the space between the talus, calcaneus, cuboid, and navicular. And on this reconstructed sagittal CT image, we again see the small bony density in that space between the four bones, but most closely approximated to the anterior process of the calcaneus. Of note, the margin of the anterior process of the calcaneus is well corticated. So we can deduce from this well corticated margin that this bony density most likely represents an accessory ossicle. So what is the most common name used for this accessory ossicle? Os calcaneus secundarius, os cuboidium secundarium, os peroneum, or os trigonum. And the answer in this case is os calcaneus secundarius. Now, if you read foot and ankle radiographs in your normal practice, you encounter os trigonum and os peroneum frequently, but these other two are relatively unusual. So this is os calcaneus secundarius, a normal variant with a 5% prevalence according to the literature. It does abut the anterior calcaneal process in the region of the bifurcate ligament attachment, usually asymptomatic, but it's important to be aware of this entity because it can be mistaken for fracture of the anterior calcaneal process. So it's important to recognize that well-corticated margin of both the ossicle itself as well as the anterior process of the calcaneus. Our next case is a 33-year-old woman with right hip pain. On this AP view of the pelvis, we see loss of the normal wasting between the femoral head and neck in a bilaterally symmetric fashion. We also see large, broad bony projections along the medial aspects of the femoral necks. And lastly, we see these small ovoid lucencies with well-corticated margins in the femoral necks as indicated by the arrows here. So the question is, the appearance of the femoral necks is due to the presence of which of these bone lesions? Enchondromas, fibrous dysplasia, non-ossifying fibromas, or osteochondromas? And to help answer this question, here is an AP standing view of both ankles showing the same pathology involving the distal tibial and fibular metadiaphyses bilaterally. And the answer in this case is osteochondromas. And this is a pathognomonic appearance for multiple hereditary osteochondromas. Osteochondromas are the most common benign tumor of bone, representing about 30% of benign bone tumors, with giant cell tumor being second, around 20% of benign bone tumors. Most osteochondromas occur around the knee, although they can be seen in pretty much any bone. They're usually asymptomatic. When patients have multiple hereditary osteochondromas, they have this pathognomonic appearance, as we see in this case of the AP pelvis with this sessile osteochondromas involving the femoral necks, that widened femoral neck appearance, the loss of the normal wasting. And we have a very similar appearance that can occur in the proximal humeri as well. Of note, patients with multiple hereditary osteochondromas have a higher risk of malignant transformation to chondrosarcoma, and that risk is about 5 to 10% according to the literature, whereas when you have a solitary osteochondroma, that risk is quite low at 1% or less. On imaging, these osteochondromas can be sessile, which means they have just a very broad base or attachment to the underlying bone, or they can be pedunculated and have somewhat of a stalk appearance. And here we see a nice pedunculated osteochondroma. And to be considered an osteochondroma, you must see that cortical medullary continuity between the osteochondroma itself and the underlying bone as indicated by these arrows. And when evaluating an osteochondroma on cross-sectional imaging, we analyze the thickness of the cartilage cap. And based on the available literature, a cap that is thicker than 1.5 or 2 centimeters raises concern for malignant transformation. On this axial fluid sensitive MR image of the ankle, we see a distal tibial osteochondroma with a thin, smooth cartilage cap that is well under the 1.5 centimeter thick cutoff. So definitely not worrisome in this case for malignant transformation. Our next case is a 27-year-old woman with chronic shoulder pain. On this axial MR arthrographic image of the shoulder at the level of the coracoid process, superior glenoid and superior humeral head, we see normal glenoid cartilage and normal posterior labral tissue, but anteriorly there is a linear plane of contrast separating the bone from this relatively thick triangular shaped low signal tissue as indicated here by the arrow. So the question in this case is, which structure is that indicated by the arrow? Is it the long head of the biceps tendon, the inferior glenohumeral ligament, the middle glenohumeral ligament, or the subscapularis tendon? Well, the answer in this case is the middle glenohumeral ligament, and this is a case of Buford complex, which is a normal variant with a reported prevalence of between 1.5 and 5%. On imaging, you'll see congenital absence or attenuation of the anterior superior labrum and a corresponding thickened cord-like middle glenohumeral ligament, as again seen by this arrow. And of course, in this area, the anterior superior labrum, there's so many different variants, but certainly this entity can be confused for a labral tear if you're not aware of all the variants that can occur in this area. Our next case is a 30-year-old man with a known inherited connective tissue disease. On these AP radiographs of both his hands, we see there is acroosteolysis of the distal phalanges of every finger bilaterally, predominantly centered in the shafts of the distal phalanges with fairly well-defined horizontal clefts of bone loss, particularly at the fingers that I've circled here. We also can see that the metacarpals are short relative to the proximal phalanges and that the carpi have a squared off configuration. Also, the distal radial ulnar joint spaces are widened and the distal ulnae are mildly deformed. And by the soft tissue outlines of the fingers, we can notice that the fingers are also short and broad. So in this patient with acroosteolysis, what is the most likely diagnosis? So I'm sure we remember from our training days and, you know, if you're current residents, there is a long differential for acroosteolysis. Some of these entities are quite rare. And of course, this is one of those extremely rare entities of Haju-Cheney. And Haju-Cheney is an inherited connective tissue disease. Only 100 cases reported in the literature. It's characterized by bone loss. Unfortunately, the mechanism is unknown. On imaging, the hands and feet, you can have acroosteolysis, usually starting at the mid-aspect of the distal phalanges, which can help differentiate Haju-Cheney from other causes of acroosteolysis, which typically start at the distal tufts instead of at the mid-portion of the shafts of the distal phalanges. These patients can have short, broad digits. They also will have manifestations in the spine with kyphosis, scoliosis, vaginal invagination, low bone mineral density, and multiple fractures. And they can also have craniofacial findings of open sutures, absent frontal sinuses, and elongated solitursica. And of course, this is not a comprehensive list, just some of the highlights of the different musculoskeletal findings in these patients. Our next case is a 57-year-old man with chronic bilateral shoulder pain. On this axillary view of the left shoulder, we see a well-demarcated lucid line through the distal acromion with well-corticated margins on each side of this line, as indicated by these arrows. Now, this normal variant may predispose to which of the following shoulder pathologies: anterior dislocation, biceps subluxation, labral tear, or rotator cuff tear. And although this is a little controversial in the literature, the correct answer in this case is rotator cuff tear. And this is a patient who has osteochromiae, an older patient, as you can see from the degenerative change here, but he also has a full thickness rotator cuff tear on the coronal view. So this is osteochromiae, a normal variant characterized by non-union of the acromial ossification centers. It has a published prevalence ranging between 1 and 15%. It is bilateral in 60% of patients and usually asymptomatic, although it has been implicated as a risk factor for impingement and rotator cuff tear in the literature. Imaging, it's best seen radiographically on the axillary view. It is important to closely evaluate your axial sequences for osteochromiae because this entity can be confused for the acromioclavicular joint on other sequences, coronal and sagittal. If it is symptomatic, you can often see edema on MRI along the synchondrosis and in the surrounding tissues. Our next case, case 8, is a 14-year-old girl with history of osteogenesis imperfecta. On these lateral views of the distal femora, bilaterally, we see skinny metallic rods proximally, which were used to correct bowing deformities in her femurs. And distally, we see multiple undulating horizontal sclerotic lines in the distal femoral and proximal tibial and fibular metadiaphyses that are fairly symmetric bilaterally. And in this patient with osteogenesis imperfecta, these wavy metaphyseal lines are due to what therapy? Bisphosphonate therapy, steroid therapy, vitamin C, or vitamin D? And the answer in this case is bisphosphonate therapy. And this is actually the manifestation of zebra lines. And osteogenesis imperfecta is an inherited connective tissue disorder characterized by multiple fractures and osteoporosis. And so these patients are treated with cyclic bisphosphonate therapy as children. Specifically, that bisphosphonate is intravenous pimidronate. And this therapy causes the inability to decalcify the cartilage along the physis due to inhibition of the osteoblastic activity. And it creates these metaphyseal bands of increased density, usually at the knee and elbow joints, but of course you can see it at the ankle as we see on the image on the far right. And this does, these zebra lines serve as a marker of the course of prior bisphosphonate treatment received. Our next case is a 31-year-old woman who lacerated her dorsal elbow during a fall. And on this reconstructed sagittal CT image of the elbow at the level of the radiocapitellar joint, we see a focal area flattening at the posterior aspect of the capitellum. Now, this capitellum demonstrates which of the following findings. Is this a vascular necrosis, a capitellar pseudo-defect, an impaction fracture, or an osteochondral defect? Now, of course, we know that this patient fell. She has a little bit of subcutaneous air dorsally there that you can see. But this is a case of capitellar pseudo-defect. She does not have a joint effusion or any other significant findings to suggest a severe fracture-type injury. So capitellar pseudo-defect is a normal variant characterized by irregularity at the posterolateral edge of the capitellum. It is a non-articulating surface, so there's no overlying cartilage in this location. On imaging, you can see an abrupt transition from the convex articular surface to that area of flattening. Differential considerations for this, of course, are osteochondral defect, but that's typically anterior underlying the cartilage surface. Also, you can get these posterior impaction injuries, but those should be associated with signs of other signs of injury, such as elbow joint effusion and soft tissue injury. Our next case is a 28-year-old woman who has paresthesia in her left hand after lifting her left arm. On this AP view of the cervical spine, if we count from the C2 level inferiorly, we can see rib-like structures at the level of C7. And the normal variant present on this radiograph can be associated with which of the following: Leriche syndrome, May-Thurner syndrome, Nutcracker syndrome, or thoracic outlet syndrome. So trying to remember the syndromes listed in choices A through C, that they are related to vascular pathologies that are well away from the cervical spine, by process of elimination, we can select thoracic outlet syndrome. And of course, this is a cervical rib, which is a congenital anomaly characterized by overdevelopment of the transverse process, usually at the C7 level, more often unilateral than bilateral, and more often left on the left than on the right. A published prevalence of between 0.5 and 1%, usually asymptomatic, but can be associated with thoracic outlet syndrome because there is very narrowed space between the cervical rib and the first rib through which the brachial plexus and subclavian artery and vein must travel. Here is a patient with thoracic outlet syndrome related to the presence of a cervical rib, and we can see both area of mild narrowing of the subclavian artery with post-stenotic dilatation. Our next case is a 16-year-old girl with chronic left wrist pain. On this AP view of the wrist, we can see increase in radial inclination, as well as ulnar positive variance, proximal migration of the lunate with associated triangular configuration of the carpus, and bowing of the radial shaft. And on the lateral view, also volar subluxation of the carpus. So the presence of which ligament helps distinguish this congenital entity from other causes of radial shortening? Cooper's ligament, ligament of Struthers, ligament of Treitz, or the Vickers ligament? So obviously some of these are nowhere near the wrist. We on this coronal fluid sensitive MR image, we nicely see this dark ligamentous band, which is called the Vickers ligament. Ligament of Struthers can occur in the distal humerus, ligament of Treitz, obviously at the duodenojejunal junction, Cooper's ligaments are in the breast. So in this case, this is the Vickers ligament. So this is a case of mad lung deformity, which is a congenital anomaly characterized by premature closure of the ulnar volar aspect of the distal radial physis due to the presence of that Vickers ligament. Females are affected more than males. Usually this, even though congenital, it doesn't manifest until adolescence, and it's often bilateral. And again, all of these imaging features that we see in our case are typical of mad lung deformity. Our next case is a 22-year-old man with fixed position of the left arm and a rash in his left axilla. On this very thick reconstructed coronal whole body CT image, we see thick bridging ossification between the proximal humeri and scapulae bilaterally, and at the left hip joint between the pelvis and the femur. And we can also partially identify severe thoracolumbar scoliosis. So the findings on this image are most compatible with which of the following diagnoses: dermatomyositis, Kresse syndrome, myositis ossificans progressiva, or scleroderma? Well, this is the case of a very rare disease called myositis ossificans progressiva. an inherited connective tissue disorder that's autosomal dominant. Other names for it include Stoneman syndrome and fibrodysplasia ossificans progressiva. It's characterized by ossification of fibrous tissue either spontaneously or when it's damaged. These endothelial cells transform to mesenchymal stem cells and then onto bone. And of course, these patients develop progressive loss of mobility. And due to that progressive loss of mobility, their lifespan is shortened to approximately 45 years. And on imaging, you'll just get this very thick, elongated areas of heterotopic ossification along muscles, tendons, and ligaments, and eventual osseous fusion of the joints. Our last case is a 37-year-old man with chronic left foot pain. And on this sagittal T1 and coronal fluid sensitive image of the ankle hind foot, you can see complete bony fusion between the talus and calcaneus. And here is a coronal CT image showing the same entity, but without the solid bony fusion. The question in this case is, which of the following radiographic signs is most often associated with the finding in the image on the right and on the initial images I showed? Is it the anteater sign, the continuous S sign, Taylor Beaking, or the zebra sign? And the answer in this case is Taylor Beaking. And this is a case of Taylor calcaneal coalition, which is a congenital abnormal bridging between the talus and the calcaneus. The two most common coalitions in the ankle hindfoot are calcaneonavicular and talocalcaneal. Overall prevalence of coalition is 1%. Males more often affected than females. It is more often bilateral than unilateral. And on imaging, you can see continuous C sign, so not the S sign, but the C sign, which is sclerosis in an inverted C shape near the angle of Gassane on the lateral view. And you can also see Taylor Beaking like we see in this case here. So that was a very rapid run through some very common, but also some extremely rare cases of normal variants, congenital anomalies, and some inherited disorders. I greatly appreciate your attention and thank you to the ARRS for inviting me.